Hi, welcome everyone on this gorgeous Monday morning here in Santa Clara on the Open Networking Summit. We are having a session today, a tutorial session on interoperability, which is a really hot topic, affects open source, and we feel it really important to talk about it. We will start with a really short introduction that who we are, and for technical reasons, we will all do this sitting down to avoid the slides in our face. So my name, I'm Ildikó Vancsa. I'm working for the OpenStack Foundation. I'm the ecosystem technical lead there. I'm working together with our member companies and community members to help them be successful with OpenStack as a software package, and also with OpenStack as an open source community. And beyond this, I'm also involved in OPNFV. I'm an OPNFV ambassador as well. I'm really passionate about helping the cross-community interactions and collaboration.
Okay, I'm Carsten Rossenhöfel, Managing Director and Co-Founder of EANTC. That's the European Advanced Networking Test Center. We are an independent commercial test lab, and my role is I'm CTO, basically, at my company, and I'm also a standards rapporteur at the ETSI NFV Industry Specification Group.
Thanks. So my name is Christopher Price. I'm elected board member of OpenStack and OPNFV, and I work for Ericsson. And today I'm bringing a vendor perspective to interoperability to try and put some balance between what comes for free and what costs us a lot, I guess. Good. Should we progress?
Yep, please switch slides. I have an own secretary today. All right, so we thought to bring you the big picture before we go into the details that how open source, the vendors and the users, operators and service providers are placed on this big picture. What's the relationship between them? What's the responsibilities of each group? And I would like to ask Carsten to introduce the diagram that you can see behind us a little bit before we go into discussion.
Sure. So the big picture, right? So what's the big picture? And probably all of you are aware of one or more or many testing initiatives that are going on in the industry. You know, everybody's testing these days, which is wonderful. You know, for a long time, you know, we've been the lab rats. And, you know, as soon as you said, like, oh, we need to do some testing. Hello, testing, quality assurance. People say, like, yeah, we'll take care of this in the last few weeks before we publish something. You know, it'll all be good. So now in this industry, testing is really at the forefront and gets much more attention, which is wonderful. And now we need to create this big picture. Like, how does everything fit together? You know, because if testing, we need to make sure that testing is not like fireworks, like, you know, boom, test event here, boom, POC there, you know, boom, some plug fest over there. We need to make sure that all of the initiatives work together and integrate in a way that the industry actually benefits. And that's the reason for this diagram. Basically, a testing pipeline we think is needed, or, you know, forms actually as we speak, similar to like the pipeline of coding. You know, OPNFV would not just take like, oh, let's reinvent code that OpenStack has done before. You know, there's this whole notion of taking into account upstream projects, code, and feeding back experiences and so on. And we think the same needs to get in place with the testing. You know, you need to take into account testing that has been done by other entities before, and you need to provide feedback to upstream testing initiatives to make them better and more automated. And that's basically what this diagram tries to explain. So basically, it all starts with open source testing, open source initiatives, and then commercial implementations are derived from open source typically, most often these days. So the commercial implementations need to be tested. Once that is done, industry-wide interoperability needs to be tested across all of these different initiatives and implementations. And in the end, the operators, the service providers, do their own testing, usually at this point, they do a lot of testing. You know, you are probably aware of the big North American operators' programs of integrating NFV solutions. It's massive testing effort. And the problem with that is the more we get on towards the right side of this diagram, the more expensive the testing becomes, because everybody is doing this in their own service provider premises, and everybody is, you know, recreating the same experiences. So the idea is, like, test plans need to be upstreamed over time, like the purple arrow pointing to the left, to basically transport that testing experience to a place where it's where testing can be better integrated and where it's cheaper, because it's only done once instead of a gazillion times. And at the same time, here it's green, there is yellow, yellowish. Anyway, so that's the reason for upstreaming tests, to reduce the cost and the effort, and also the time it takes to do this. At this time, I heard from, you know, some unnamed sources that integrating virtualized network function into production takes typically like a year or more, and that's surprisingly long. And in order to reduce this experience that service providers are seeing, we need to implement this testing pipeline. And the last part is, of course, on the blue arrow pointing to the right, the integration level increases. Not all testing can be done on the far left side of this diagram, because naturally, you know, the more you get towards the service provider implementation, the more individual, the more integrated, the more end-to-end the solution becomes.
Yep. Do you want to say something? I was going to add a little. I think one of the things this diagram sort of presents that we're going to get into a little bit more today is that each of these blocks has a different owner or a different responsible entity. Open source testing, it's very much a community-driven activity. Commercial integration, that's a vendor responsibility. And then the industry-wide interoperability is cross-vendor and other neutral parties. And then you get to the operator-led integration at the end. What we see, or I think what we would hope to see coming out as we move into an NFV environment, is that there's less responsibility split between these. The arrows sort of indicate that things need to start to flow one way or the other. And NFV provides an opportunity for us to do that, in that historically the operator-led individual testing was installing boxes, plugging in cables, putting power, and so on and so forth. In a virtual environment, it can be running a script. And that's when you can start to do this sort of thing. But in order to be able to run a script, there is an ocean of work that has to go into creating an environment where that script will actually work. And I think that's one of the things we're going to dig into a little bit and sort of talk about how we're getting there.
Good. Yep, thanks. I think just one more thing to mention here is the importance that no matter where you're sitting, I mean, which part of the pipeline you and or your company are representing, we all have our responsibilities in this pipeline, and it's not one box that will carry all the burden and the others will use and benefit from it. We all need to do our own work in order to make interoperability happen. All right, so we will go through a little bit on this pipeline, and we will start with the open source interoperability parts, what we can do there, why it is important. We can switch one more slide. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So we have this tutorial today because we said that interoperability is important, but why do we need to have a tutorial about it? Why is it not that simple and easy? Because you would think that, okay, we have a few tests, we plug things together, it seems to work, then it will be all fine. Which could be like this, but it's way more complex than that, because whenever we get to an open source component that's kind of a base of our systems more and more nowadays, we would like it to be modular, flexible. We would like to configure it in various ways. And therefore, when we get what we want, we get all this flexibility in it, and we can just use it as a box of Legos in our environment. We have to realize that validating and verifying that it really works, it really does what we want to, the pieces are really fitting together, becomes a really, really difficult game to play. Because whenever you change a configuration option, that will change behaviors, that will change how things integrate together, and there are just so many things that can, let's say, go wrong or make the process that Carsten just mentioned maybe even longer than that year or two. Therefore, we need to look into what we would like to achieve, what problems that creates for us in the field of interoperability, what challenges we have, and how can we solve them. So you can just see a few examples mentioned that how we figure out policies, how we make them discoverable, how we can deal with, for example, release cadence, which is always a topic in the discussions, because obviously we would like to have new features and all the bug fixes and everything out as soon as possible and as quickly as possible. So when, for example, we are talking about a 6-month release cadence, sometimes that even that sounds a longer period, but when you look at the open source part as the base component that someone has to productify and work on it, then it turns out that the release cadence, even a half year one, can be really, really fast, which can result in many versions and many release versions in production, which have to be able to talk to each other and interoperate with each other, which gets a really, really challenging problem when you face it and try to do it yourself.
I just want to add, so the release cadence is important because it dictates how the industry has to react. And it's a good point. One of the things which helps with a fast release cadence is stability. We talk about OpenStack as not being usable and so on and so forth for many years. It's 7 years old now. It's reaching a certain level of maturity, and thus you can start to adapt to the changes that come through that community and are exposed through the community. I think one of the challenges we face across the industry is that not everyone's as mature as OpenStack at this point in time when it comes to the cloud environment. So the release cadence is really important. A shorter release cadence means less change from how do I adopt and into work with this, but then it also means that I have very short cycles that I have to get out into the network. And as we talked, we still don't have all the pieces in place where we can go to an operator network and run a script. And if I'm going to do something every 3 months, I'm going to need to have everything automated. Anyway, sorry.
No, thank you. It was good extension to what I said. And as you mentioned, OpenStack, we can switch to the next slide. So I brought here OpenStack as an example for you, because as Chris mentioned, we started to build the community and to build the code base 7 years ago. It started with, I think our first big event was 75 people, and then 6 years later we had 7,500. We have millions of lines of code and thousands of developers and engineers working together from all around the globe. So as the years passed by and the code base started to grow, and not just the code base but also the functionality that the software package provides, we had to realize that we need to think about interoperability, and we need to take on the responsibility of the open source side. We need to help our ecosystem and ecosystem companies who are working with the software to be able to ensure that what we are producing and what they are putting into production that meets the certain levels of quality, and they will be able to build it into bigger systems as easily as possible. Therefore, the community and the foundation created a working group, which is today called Interoperability Working Group. The mission of this group is to ensure interoperability and work on the testing initiatives of this. In this working group, we have obviously the whole community involved. It's a public activity, fully open. But beyond this, we have the OpenStack board and the OpenStack technical committee actively working in this group. So it's really something that we think we are all responsible for, and we take it as a high priority activity. It was founded in late 2013, and by 2015 we got our first guidelines produced, because this group is working on creating guidelines and not implementing the test cases themselves on the first place. The guidelines are consisting of a list of capabilities that the software needs to provide. It identifies code parts and components that has to run, and it also identifies tests that it needs to fulfill. And these guidelines, and whenever a software component fulfills the guidelines that this group provides, it means that for example, the distribution that a vendor provides can use the OpenStack logo, because we say that they fulfilled what we identified as requirements, and it guarantees you that you will get what you expect from that platform when it gets deployed, and you will access the APIs. This group works with a tool set. So if we switch one more slide, this is called RefStack. This is integrated into our Tempest framework, which we use as an integration test framework within OpenStack. So you can run the interoperability tests as part of that framework. The tests are usually run locally on premise, and the results are uploaded to our website and stored in a database and gets evaluated after that. And one step back. The interoperability working group produces a new guideline every half year. It covers three OpenStack releases, and the board and the TC are voting on what goes into the guideline and what tests are going into the test suite. These are the tests that you need to run against a certain version of OpenStack. It gets the APIs validated, and I think later on we will go into that, that what are the aspects of testing and what do you want to get tested. For OpenStack, we are testing the APIs, and we are testing the user-facing APIs, which is important to mention. So for example, you will not find anything within the test suite that would be, let's say, an admin-only API, for example, or something that's intentionally pluggable, like, for example, middlewares or drivers. You will only find there what's user-facing, what everyone is able to access, who has the product access.
So just to chime in, on the RefStack or the interop working group outcome, as a vendor, that provides you with a guideline, and it provides you with a dialogue with other vendors, where you're able to sit down and agree, this is what we will all support. We will all make sure that these capabilities are presented when we have an OpenStack logoed product. Thus, as a consumer, as an operator, or someone building onto OpenStack, it doesn't matter whose cloud I'm running against, it doesn't matter who is vending it, I can trust that I will have these user-facing interfaces. And this is the first point in the entire value chain where we start to establish some sort of trust between the consumer and what's being produced. So it's really important. There you go. My input.
Thank you. But OpenStack is just one piece. It provides an open source cloud platform. You can use it for private public clouds or part of a multi-cloud environment, but you can also look at it as part of a bigger system. So if we switch slides, I can just hand back the mic to Chris, and we can look into how OpenStack fits into the bigger ecosystem. We will touch on OPNFV and see how this all works out.
Thanks. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the OPNFV CVP, Compliance and Verification Program. We kicked this off last year from OPNFV in order to try and achieve what OpenStack is achieving, to try and achieve a level of trust and certainty about what it is that we're producing. So the CVP is set up against a set of fundamental principles and objectives. The objectives, I guess, are the most important thing. We want to essentially help build a market. We want to try and reduce risk for operators and end users. We want to make it easy for people to consume what we're producing in OPNFV. And as with OpenStack, the RefStack toolchain, to produce an automated way of building trust with a consumer. OPNFV is slightly different than OpenStack, though. OPNFV, we have opinions about who our customers are and what we're trying to serve, which are a little bit more constrained than, I think, OpenStack in general. We are trying to address the telecoms market. We are trying to address NFV. Thus, we have certain expectations around what the control plane should do. We have requirements around how it should be deployed. We have requirements around how an application should behave when it's on the platform. And we have expectations around what the platform should actually look like that it's running on. What is the hardware? How is it configured? And so on and so forth. So our CVP is maybe a little different in that OpenStack provides you with a way of producing trust for a consumer. The OPNFV then takes that to the next level, which is how to build a way of starting to establish characteristics of a system which can then be trusted. And we'll get into that a little bit moving forwards. I wanted to talk back as to where the CVP came from. Where is the foundation for the CVP? It's a great idea. Let's do some sort of standard way of doing stuff. It's hard to do that just at the outset. So we have been in OPNFV building a lot with our upstream communities. We work a lot with the OpenStack testing. We work with Open Daylight, with ONOS, OVS, with FDIO. And we take those tests and we integrate those tests. So when we spin up an OPNFV-based data center, we then run many thousands of tests against them, which are primarily coming from upstream communities. We don't carry our own code, or we try not to carry our own code. So all of our code is based on upstream, and we contribute back upstream. So if we're working with OpenStack, we're writing code in OpenStack, and we're consuming that. And our test cases are very much aligned with the OpenStack testing. So we pull Tempest, we pull Rally, we pull Robot, we pull a number of different test frameworks, and then execute them in an NFV context. So what OPNFV does essentially is it takes a lot of open source software, provides an NFV context for it, and then allows us to automate validating that software in that context. And so this is sort of an overview of the test framework that we have in OPNFV. We have the compliance activity which we're incubating today, and the Dovetail is the project we use for that. And then we have a number of functional testing activities based around a common framework which we call Funk Test. And furthermore, we do a number of performance testings where we can either be doing data plane testing, we can be doing resilience testing, we can be doing failover testing, which fit into another bracket, if you like. And then we have tiers through which these tests can start to build. At this point in time, we're still relatively young as a community. We don't have the 7 years behind us that OpenStack have. So a lot of these are, I guess, not as well governed as they potentially could be, which is why we're still incubating our CVP activity. But it gives you a general idea of what we have as far as a testing foundation is concerned. What we're trying to do then is between that framework and the little map on the right is actually representative of a project we call Pharos. That's our hardware labs project. We have a number of labs you can see spread over the globe, and what a Pharos lab provides is a fixed infrastructure that complies to OpenNFV's view of an NFV cloud, that we can run any particular composition of a stack software against. So what we do there is we deploy, we test, and we iterate. And we deploy, and we test, and we iterate. We build data centers on a daily basis. Well, we build hundreds of data centers on a daily basis. I remember I was on the keynote here a couple of years ago, and I was able to claim that we'd spun up 1,700 clouds by the time this conference was on. I couldn't even imagine what that's like today. We've grown considerably since then. But what OpenNFV does is it builds a cloud up. It tests, it validates, it makes sure that the features that we want to see in that cloud are there, and then it tears it down and starts again with a slightly different flavor with Open Daylight or with ONOS or with OVS or with FDIO. Or we're able to basically integrate all of these into a cloud environment. So we deploy, we test, we iterate constantly. We use ETSI as a very good reference for how we should be testing and what we should be testing. We integrate that into our test activities. We also take IETF test standards and we use those in the same context. So what we're trying to do is take what's happening in the standards world and apply that to what's happening in the open source world in a telecoms context so that we start to do this real-time integration and we start to prove things very quickly. There's a cycle, though. Because we do this over and over again, we're able to evaluate, and then we're able to improve, and then we're able to iterate again. So every time we find a fault or every time we find something new, we push it back upstream. If we're going to write a test case for an OpenStack feature, we will generally potentially do it in our own repository to start with, but eventually we'll push that upstream to OpenStack as quickly as we can. So we have this cycle going round and round where we've been able to improve the quality of our testing and improve essentially the quality of what it is that we're testing for telecommunications environments. And what we get out of that is we get a very good knowledge of how to use OpenStack, how to work with Cloud Native, how to use Open Daylight, KVM, how to work with Linux in an NFV environment, what it means when I have different Linux distros with KVM and another, guest operating system on top. How does this behave in different scenarios when I compose different components together into a platform and run it in a telecommunications context? What it further provides us is a way of upstreaming that, because if we go back to OpenStack, for instance, and say, hey, we've been running these tests, and here is how it looks, and here is what we're trying to achieve, and here are the faults we found, then it's very clear for them to understand why we're trying to make a change or why we think this is a problem, and then we can work very quickly with them. So the CVP, as we move forwards, we plan to release this year and have our first CVP. When we release that, we hope to be releasing that with a number of upstream components, and RefStack, of course, the toolchain that OpenStack provides, gives us a really neat foundation for the cloud testing, and we're working with the Interop Working Group to try and identify if we need an NFV-based variant of that that we can then adopt and use, and that's an ongoing discussion, I guess. So hopefully what we see happening then is through the OpenNFV CBP, we can then have an NFV reference in RefStack for OpenStack that people can use in their own contexts. Because at the end of the day, it's not all about one project or the other. It's about all of these projects figuring out how to work together. So that's, I guess, the CBP in short form. The other thing, guys, if you've got any questions, just raise your hand, and we'll be happy to take them. We're trying to be conversational. I speak fast and I get through my slides fast, so you'll be leaving early if you don't stop us and ask some questions. Not that that's a good thing, mind you.
I do have, I don't know if it's a comment or a question, hopefully it leads into a discussion, but it seems like even from the very first slide, you're assuming that operators are going to wait until Ericsson or some other vendor comes out with a release of, say, OpenNFV, and then we're going to start a testing process to start looking to possibly deploy it. Are you also looking to try to pull these same operators in immediately and have them being collaborators up front such that you don't deliver a car and they go, well, yeah, but I really didn't really want a manual transmission. You know, I'm worried that there's still this concept of the long pipeline. We're going to have this full release and you're going to get it to the operators and the operators are going to go, well, this is great, but it isn't. We're going to have to figure out a way to make this innovation work versus being a part of the process of innovation. Is that what you're implying here, or are you still looking to try to find ways to get operators into the pipeline earlier?
We've absolutely found ways. Well, no, we haven't. The operators have absolutely found ways of getting into the pipeline, and everyone's very happy about that. I think I want to flick. I'm going to flick a bunch just to go back right to here, because what we have is a traditional flow, right? A traditional flow. You've got these lines, and we sort of talked about trying to blur those lines a little bit, in that what we might be doing for the operator-led individual testing previously, we want to start to push that back up the track. We do have operators. We have AT&T, for instance, heavily invested in Open Daylight and using that in their network and contributing test cases. And we have AT&T and OpenNFV contributing test cases and actually helping drive a number of the feature projects we have there. Orange is a really good example of a group that have invested a lot in testing in OpenNFV. The structure of that test architecture has a lot to do with a guy called Morgan Rickom from Orange France. I think what we've actually started to do already is break those walls down. We still have, from a commercial perspective, there are still gates we have to pass through. But what we're managing to do is shift the dial a little bit as to who's involved where and when. And I think it's a really good question, because if that wasn't clear, I think it's something that we're trying to sort of project as well as we move forward.
And I just wanted to say to this point that you mentioned, for example, AT&T, we have them in OpenStack as well. And so when we are talking about open source, yes, these are communities consisting of developers, but the developers are in most of the cases employed by companies like AT&T or Orange or Ericsson or all those ecosystem companies. So it's not, this pipeline is not really like, there is open source, which is some kind of a cloudy blurry, we don't know what that is, and then the vendors come, and then the operators come. This is whole of a mixture. So open source also provides a place for the vendors and the operators and service providers to collaborate in one place, so they can way earlier in the process share their feedback and participate in the process. So open source does not only mean open code base, it also means the open testing initiatives. So we also would like to encourage all of you to come and participate, find these groups, find where the activities are ongoing, and help us to bring it to the next level. And also many of these companies are running these open source releases, just, you know, downloaded from GitHub as proof of concept installations and in labs. So it's not, I think that in most cases it's not true that they see the whole thing as in the form of a distribution. For the first time, they already tested it in labs. They already tried to figure out what it's capable of, how they can use it. They will just not put the pure open source version into production, but operators will work with vendors to get the distribution, get it in deployed, managed, supported, and all these sort of things. That makes the business run.
So, I don't know what your view is, but actually, I think the operators are also getting way more involved in the whole process now recently with virtualization again. Because a couple of years back, you know, we've been around for like 25 years, and we've done a lot of transport network testing. And you know, in the MPLS transport times, the operators got very, how do you say in English, laid back. So basically, it's like, okay, the whole industry will do their game, and in the end, we'll just buy what's available. And that doesn't work anymore. And I think it's very reassuring to see that the operators try to get involved in this whole pipeline at as early as possible. And you talked about open source. I can talk about ETSI standardization. Operators are very active there and trying to steer things. Of course, everything has a horizon. You know, at day one, an operator probably doesn't know exactly how to deploy a 5G mobile core in 2 years from now. So there will always need to be some testing on the right-hand side. By the way, there are still a few more seats here if you want to get seated. Even, I mean, the first row, obviously, but also here on the second and third row.
We don't bite.
Not often. So I did want to, so just to sort of sum up where I was coming to and going from. There's a couple of initiatives that I wanted to call out. There is an initiative called XCI, which is ongoing today, and that goes from OpenStack to Open Daylight to OpenNFV to FIDO to OVFS. It's across almost, well, not almost, but where intention is to be across all of this. The intention of that initiative is that we establish continuous delivery from open source projects, true continuous delivery from open source projects, and then we have continuous integration in their consuming entities. What that means is that any given day, at any given time, I can spin up the latest software from Trunk and run it. And that's critical, because what that enables is the next thing that we're working on, and that is not as mature. You won't see any stickers or anything around it yet, but there is a cross-project test strategy initiative spinning up. So the plan there is that if I happen to be writing some code in FDIO, for instance, on the forwarding plane, and I'm targeting, you know, an operator's central office deployment, then I should be able to push a patch, and my patch will go into Garrett, and that will run a few jobs, and it will start to build, and the continuous deployment will kick in, and that patch will eventually, not in seconds, but minutes to hours, make its way into a data center solution that is actually deploying and validating that feature end to end. Thus, I have the ability to have a test chain for any patch that I push that validates that patch, no matter what component it happens to be in, end to end in the network. These are kind of huge activities. They're not huge in the context that there's millions of people working on them. There's a few small groups really starting to incubate this, but the change that they can bring into how we approach these types of problems is enormous.
So I'm playing audience for a moment.
Yeah.
Is that going to be a bag of rice problem? You say this in English as well. You know, the bag of rice trips in China, and then nobody cares. But in fact, you know, if you would include a small change in some open source code, and it basically starts rebuilding the whole test for all OpenNFV flavors and Open Daylight and ONOS and Open Contrail, and then it gets into OpenStack, and basically the world's servers will be busy for a week because of one line of code change. How do you manage the whole flavors of configuration?
Through intelligent planning. So it's part of the, I talked about continuous deployment before I moved into continuous integration, because understanding how the continuous deployment feeds into the continuous integration and how that stepwise chain approaches to the point where you get that end-to-end solution is really important. It's not seconds, it could be minutes to hours, because you don't necessarily want every patch to propagate through the network. You want to be able to do that in a managed and maintainable way. So essentially what you do is you do set up a cadence across all the components that enable them to have a trustable cadence of deployment and testing, that then everything sort of feeds into in a manageable way. It's not done yet. It's a work in progress, and I don't know how it looks.
Cool,
I can't
idea.
Explain it today. So we did, before I move to the next slide, I wanted to ask some questions just briefly. So it's good to know who you're talking to, and we haven't actually asked yet. So if I break the audience up into I am an operator, I am an NFVI vendor, I'm an application vendor, or I'm none of the above. Could you just sort of raise your hand so that we know who we're talking about? So if you work for an operator who's going to be operating telecoms networks. Cool. Okay. For an NFVI vendor, someone selling cloud platform. Just keep raising your hand. Who is it? And then for application developers, do we have any application developers?
And a number of none of the above.
Feeling very, very lonely, yeah. A number of none of the above, I guess, yeah. Okay. Great. All right, thanks, guys. So that's kind of the open source world. It's moving fast. It's extremely exciting. There's a lot going on. But the challenge comes when you sort of move into commercial interoperability. It's fine to solve everything in the open source world, but then we need to move into the point where we have maybe more accountability. And for this, I'm going to hand over to Carsten.
Okay, thanks. So just a quick intro slide. I'm not sure how many of you know EANTC. So we're an independent test lab. We mostly test commercial implementations. We test them both together with vendors and with service providers and also with enterprises and governments, but that doesn't play a role here. So we're seeing commercialized implementations, typically in NFV, of open source projects. So basically a vendor X takes OPNFV implementation or takes an OpenStack implementation, modifies it, expands it, amends it by proprietary aspects, and then releases it. And then we get to test it. So we can move to the next slide. Didn't want to put too much propaganda to you. So basically I tried to summarize the state of the NFV industry, and of course that's non-authoritative, and I also don't have like a huge amount of public data that I can throw at you. We do have some experiences from NIA that I'm going to talk about later. So basically, if you look at the left-hand side, that's the probably familiar ETSI reference diagram. It consists of the NFV infrastructure in the bottom, paired with the virtual infrastructure management. So these two typically come together. Then there are these blue VNFs, which are the virtualized network functions, together with their element manager, which manages the virtualized network function at the application level. And on the right-hand side, there are two green modules, functional blocks, which are called VNF manager, VNFM, and NFV orchestrator. These two together are often also called the management and network orchestration MANO. And then on top of this sits the big white elephant, which is called the next gen OSS, which nobody really knows about yet. So what are we looking for? And that's on the right-hand side. We're looking for interoperability, of course, but then the other big question here is performance. And we didn't talk about the types of testing. Maybe we can do this later on, but interoperability is wonderful, and that's like the bare bone, what you actually definitely need as a mandatory precondition to get anything running. But the question number two, basically the next morning, will be how efficient does a solution work? Because if you have to substitute like a two rack unit traditional firewall with like two full racks of x86 servers, that's not going to fly well. So efficiency and scalability is the next question. And then the one after that, especially for telecom operators, is high availability. And I think that's where, as far as I can see, there is quite a substantial difference between how enterprises use OpenStack and how service providers use OpenStack, because service providers are into a different way of high availability. They don't just say, like, okay, any service can die at any moment. They have to understand exactly like which service dies exactly when and how do our customers continue doing their stuff, even while it's dying. And then, of course, the big new thing is manageability. I think that's basically what the business case lives and dies with. In a multi-vendor world, the whole manageability of getting services instantiated, torn down, migrated, moved around data centers, getting service chains of, you know, virtual firewall plus virtual router service spun up. All of this is governed by management in solutions. And so manageability is a topic that we see much more as a testing focus than in the past. In the past, transport network, you know, people just either used command line interfaces or they used their homegrown management implementation, and that doesn't work anymore. Okay, we can go to the next slide, and basically this is going to build into different flavors of how to deploy this. The first and most simple flavor is to just buy everything from one vendor. And actually, I was surprised, but there are some service providers out there who follow this model. So, for example, I'm not sure if, I think that's public, but I'll be careful here on the microphone. So there is pretty well-known service provider in Western Europe, in a mid-sized Western European country, and they just buy everything from one vendor. And so they said, actually, it works fine. You know, we're happy. We're happy people, you know, for now. And we buy the infrastructure from the vendor. We buy the VNFs, mobile core, and everything from the same vendor. We buy the management from the same vendor. And we also buy the billing systems, the management systems, the OSS from the same single vendor. And, of course, you have a very clear responsibility in this case. There is no finger pointing. There is no questioning of, like, why doesn't it work? It's very clear. And I tried to represent this with these little smileys on the right-hand side, basically to say, like, both on the performance side and on the high availability side, on the advanced functionality side, it's it's pretty much well understood by some solution vendors out there, not you know huge amounts, but there are quite a few that understand the game and are able to implement it. The problem is this is not what most service providers started with as a thought, like why would we even want to virtualize? And one of the reasons was to, you know, buy best of breed solutions, be more agile, be more flexible, and not also not be required, not required to issue RFPs for the whole network and everything in one piece. So that's why I think the majority today try to go at least for this model, which says we still buy a lot from the same vendor, like the infrastructure and the MANO, and maybe also the next generation OSS, but we reserve the right to buy VNFs from different vendors. So that's the first level of integration that almost everybody in the industry is seeing right now. You have an infrastructure, you have a management, and then you need to integrate VNFs, plug them into this environment. And these VNFs can be, you know, virtual routers, virtual firewalls, virtual DPI, virtual mobile core, policy management, you name it, all of them. And typically the RFPs go out and then there are a couple of implementations tested and plugged in. And that's where I would expect the solution to still be quite well interoperable. It's a straightforward game, I think. But in fact, that takes service providers often like a year or more. And we had an experience in our lab. You know, we don't normally cancel tests, right? So we get into testing projects, we run tests, we write a report, and in the then sometimes there is a second round if something fails, and in the end, mostly it works. But we've actually had one or two tests which were formally cancelled because of the finger pointing between the VNF and the NFVI vendor. You know, like, oh, this is your fault. No, it's yours. And that's what can happen in the industry. We'll talk about NFVI-TI, which is one way to prevent this from happening. But I think I'm still pretty confident on some aspects of light multi-vendor. Like the service agility and functionality is good because you can choose from different VNFs, but manageability might be more difficult because the element managers from different vendors have to plug in with the orchestration. And also the performance usually is a big question mark because that depends on exactly this like multi-platform, multi-flavor testing to really work. And even the small change of a BIOS parameter can throw people back, you know, a couple of days in testing. Okay, so the end goal, as far as I see it, would be like a total of 4+ vendors in this environment. And basically, typically, you service providers buy infrastructure from one group of vendors or from one vendor, MANO from a second vendor, and the VNFs from other vendors again. And in this case, of course, there are a couple of interfaces that need to be multi-vendor ready, especially the one on the right-hand side are the more difficult ones, the one between the MANO and the infrastructure. The industry starts testing that right now. And as you can see, there are a couple of red smileys, but there are also a lot of question marks. And the question marks mean I don't even have enough data. The industry hasn't tested these commercial implementations broadly enough yet for me to even get to a mature idea of how this is going to work. But I think a lot of work is ahead of us there. So we talked about open source testing initiatives, another testing initiative that verifies commercial implementations and is the new IP agency. We are the test lab that currently works for the new IP agency. I don't plan to be the only test lab working for the new IP agency, but for now we're piloting the program. And this is a not-for-profit industry association, like many industry forums exist out there, and its primary focus areas and goals are to educate the industry and to do industry-wide testing. So we actually take into, you know, we accept anybody from whichever camp or open source group they're coming, and we test the commercialized implementations. So far we've done two major programs of VNF to NFVI interoperability, which is like the light multi-vendor model, as I explained. And this interoperability, we validated different commercial virtualized network functions interoperability with commercial NFV infrastructures. And we started that in December 2015. We ran quite a few combinations. I'll explain which. And last year in the summer, we did a first showcase of the whole heavy multi-vendor interoperability. I think it was really just like fireworks, you know, to the first showcase in this area with some of our members. And we're going to substantiate this with a more structured manual interoperability testing program starting right now. So basically, we're testing the orchestrators, NFVOs, and VNFMs from one vendor group, together with the infrastructure from the second vendor group, together with VNFs from the third vendor group. So that's going to be a lot of testing and requires automation as well. And in the blue circle, we as ENTC, not the new IP agency, but my company, ENTC, participated in the first ETSI plug test of the same area of the management and network orchestration. So to give you an impression of what this looks like, we create a database as well. And by the way, I'd love to interface with databases that open source projects maintain. I think that's part of the testing pipeline paradigm, that we need to get the results stored in a kind of interoperable way. So you see on the left-hand side the VNFs, on the top you see the NFVI, so these are the vendors that provided their solutions for our tests so far for the VNF to NFVI testing. And you see a number of passes, you see a number of NAs, because we refused to test same vendor to same vendor. So we said, like, this test combination is not available. They can do this internally. And there are still a lot of open empty slots. And these empty slots should not happen in the end, right? So in a fully automated world, we should have all of this matrix filled. Currently, most of the testing time is spent in configuring, adapting, and doing pre-staging. So it's not easy to automate all of it because of the many different ways how vendors configure their solutions. And we have to work on filling the empty slots. So the results were pretty good, I would say, in general. So if you look at 36 vendor-to-vendor combinations passed, 17 was failed or not completed due to time constraints, which means like vendors didn't completely give up, but they couldn't get things done within the time we had available for them. And that is a total success rate about two-thirds. I think that's representative as far as I'm concerned. And of course, the success rate of tests always depends on how advanced the tests are. So if we would make the tests too simple, of course, everybody could pass. Most people test lifecycle management these days, like onboarding VNFs, instantiating them, tearing them down, manipulating some operational parameters, and that's going to be that's becoming better. But I plan to keep the success level at around two-thirds. I think that means our tests are challenging enough and actually provide an added value. Right. So, good question. Thanks. So I'll repeat it for the microphone. So we're reporting only pass combinations and not failed combinations. The reason for that is that, in the commercial world, you always work under NDAs, non-disclosure agreements, and the NDAs are sometimes a nuisance, but sometimes they're also great, because under an NDA, a vendor is going to be much, much more open. So if you want to test something that's really innovative and really new, you have to sign an NDA, and then the vendor will disclose the latest and greatest. If we were to report failed combinations, we could not have these NDAs, which means the vendors would only bring their most proven, most well-established implementations, which are probably a year old, or they would not come at all. And so that's why we report only the pass combinations. And the other reason is that, in my experience in the industry, anybody who participates in the test and who fails something really wants to try to learn from it. I mean, that's the whole point, right? anything, you know, participating in a test campaign only to show past results is nice for marketing, but after all, it's a waste of money. So you really have to learn from the experience of failed tests. If we were, I mean, so the vendors that participate run back to their labs, fix this, and hopefully come back a couple of months later with the next campaign and pass more tests. The only ones that we should really worry about are the ones that are not mentioned here in the table at all, because they didn't invest in the testing. So on this interoperability showcase that we ran at a big communications event in Austin last year, we saw that there is no two-dimensional matrix anymore. And that's the one of the big problems with more advanced multi-vendor testing. So each of these little, okay, it's barely readable, but each of these little topology diagrams on the left-hand side, there are a total of six. They have multi-vendor combinations with the NFVI, with the VNFs, with the MANO. So you see it's a three-dimensional matrix for now. And testing a three-dimensional matrix, of course, a huge, more added amount of work compared to a two-dimensional matrix. So that underlines, again, we need to automate the whole thing. And the results were nice. There were a couple of implementations, interoperability that worked, and especially we tested service chains of multiple VNFs chained or connected to each other in a forwarding graph and providing advanced services. We tested them in some cases even with a MANO coming from a different vendor as the NFV infrastructure, and we got a number of combinations going, and that's what we have to work on further to broaden this whole experience.
Have you thought about testing on an open source NFVI?
Testing on an open source NFVI, yes, of course. And typically, our challenge is to get this supported. Because if we knock on the door of OpenNFV and say, like, are you supporting your implementation in terms of like sending engineers to a test and then fixing bugs, together with the vendors, this is not how open source projects normally work. Maybe we can change this, but in general, typically we require a vendor who supports an open source implementation, and this vendor will then provide the support. We had thought about just taking a few servers and installing OpenNFV, for example, or just a Colorado release or whatever ourselves, but then the big question is like, who is going to provide support for it?
Like it's a challenge. We managed to get the OpenNFV into the, well, I guess it comes up soon, in the ETSI plug test recently. But the only way to do that was for vendors to volunteer resources. So Intel and Ericsson, for instance, volunteered a bunch of resources for a few weeks just to make sure that we could run the open source stuff in that context. And then, of course, that was me that arranged the Ericsson side. And I got beaten because we spent money, and what did we get out of it? Well, we actually got some good stuff out of it, but it's difficult for a vendor to actually be able to say, okay, we need to spend thousands of dollars on running this open source software here. It's a non-trivial challenge, I guess.
Yeah, so Ericsson joined the new IP agency, and I hope we'll see some OpenNFV implementation there soon as well. Okay, so upcoming is manual tests, and I'm just highlighting this because of the underlying test plans. So whenever you run a test, of course, there should be a test plan. That's the big difference between a test and a plugfest. A plugfest, or even further earlier in the pipeline, a hackfest, is a lightly planned activity from my point of view. So you're basically relying on the experience of the participants. You're relying on their understanding of the relevance of what they do. On a hackfest even more, and on a plugfest as well, you basically lock people into a room and hope that something worthwhile will come out if you throw a couple of topics at them. For our tests, we provide much more detailed test plans, and I think these test plans shall be available for the whole industry and not only for a single test, again, speaking in favor of the pipeline paradigm. So in the new IP agency, we're not creating proprietary test plans, we're only creating open test plans, and we're doing this through the ETSI NFV industry specification group. So
NIA, actually, new IP agency, doesn't even have a technical committee by intention. We say any resources that are knowledgeable and can contribute to a test plan should go to ETSI. So I'm rapporteur for the ETSI TST007 document, and it has nothing to do with James Bond, and it's actually an interoperability test plan for the management and network orchestration. So it's currently still in a so-called early draft, but we have like the 10th version of it, and we plan to get into a stable draft by the next ETSI meeting in May and get it ratified before September or something. So it's in a pretty good shape. So what are the challenges of commercial implementations? We published detailed test reports. You can read them on uipagency.com or on light reading or just Google. And interestingly, we saw a fairly large number of issues. We documented them in detail. And then we had a call with the OpenStack team, I think it was 2 months ago. And I basically listed all my challenges, and the response from your colleagues was like, okay, this is an education challenge, this is a commercial adaptation challenge, this is, you know, just a pure commercial issue. So we saw that this pipeline is really necessary, because not all problems can be finger pointed back to open source. So what vendors do is they take the code and they implement it, sometimes on their own. I mean, a couple vendors, of course, are looking more towards Red Hat or Canonical now for like a centralized maintenance of at least the NFVI. But typically, vendors take code from open source and then they modify it. In the best case, they just, you know, provide the modifications back. In the worst case, they branch off. And that typically means there are quite a few releases behind. So we tested a lot of Kilo and Liberty release stuff last year, which I'm not sure if it's still supported at all. You know, it's like old stuff from the OpenStack view, but from the telecom vendor view, it's still, you know, how fast they can work. And of course, you get into a version interoperability issues. You know, the one version doesn't work with the other, and the VNF assumes like a more advanced environment. That's one thing. Then another point is the whole policy improvements. You know, security aspect is always important for telecoms, and it's implemented. Security aspects are implemented in OpenStack, but you know, the more restrictive you make the isolation of tenants or services, the more you get into problems. So there was often an issue that we saw. And I think it was also mostly due to configuration or lack of understanding. But that's the reality today. And the last part is licensing. ETSI has now started some work on licensing alignment. Naturally, commercial licensing is something that open source projects would not deal with traditionally, right? I mean, there are no licenses in open source. So why even start a project? And in reality, of course, in the commercial world, licenses are a big point, and everybody does licensing in a different way. So we had a lot of issues with VNFs not working because they lost contact to their license server, or, you know, weird things happening. So we hope to be to provide as much details as needed to reproduce and fix these issues back to open source where feasible, and for all of the other parts, we just need to educate the vendor world and tell the new joiners that they should look at these aspects and try to avoid them.
There's another aspect to the implementation deviations, I guess. If you turn your mind back to when Juno and Kilo were being developed, that was a period where a lot of telecommunications vendors were showing up at OpenStack and waving their hands in the air and saying, guys, this is terrible, we can't get anything done. There were, and that's indicative that there were gaps between what the telecommunications industry required and what the OpenStack community had as a foundation. Since then, I think there's been a lot of good work done by the OpenStack community and by the telecommunications company by stop waving their hands and actually getting down and contributing. But those gaps are closing between the need and what's available. And I think this is something which speaks very strongly to open source in general, in that we found a way to move forwards, we found a way to find a common foundation. And I would put money that we're not going to see the same interoperability issues that we have had traditionally, because we've learnt and we iterate and we fix this moving forwards. And I would suggest from Mataka onwards, it will be smoother sailing for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're progressing with the topics, and I think MANO interoperability is currently the issue. Towards the end of this year in Q4, we want to look at the integration of SDN and NFV in the telecom industry. Everybody always says SDN and NFV as if it is a six-letter acronym, but of course nobody really understands, or few people understand, what does it actually mean to create interoperability and to integrate an SDN orchestration and an NFV orchestration into a common end-to-end service. What happens, you know, if data center X failed and all of the associated paths, like the SDN flows towards customers, they all need to be migrated to another data center together with the services, for example. So that's my hope for 2018, to get something working on a multi-vendor level there. And then one big area where I think a lot of interoperability challenges exist right now is resource management. Of course, service providers hope to be able to use their data centers in a flexible way, you know, to share workloads, to scale things up and down as the customer services require on the application level. And that resource management doesn't really exist or doesn't work well today.
I think we're probably due a short plug on the Open Network Automation Platform project. Which is for those that aren't familiar with it, it's being launched this week, I believe, formally, ONAP. It's essentially the network operators have come together and said, "Whoops," for very good reasons. They weren't able to operate their networks, but they've actually come together and collaborating on building an OSS, BSS, next gen solution into the MANO layer as well. And they're inviting the vendors to come along, and it's really an interesting dialogue to watch, because this is where, you know, AT&T, China Mobile, Orange, Bell Canada, these guys are sort of getting there, and then they call up the Ericssons, Ciscos, Nokias, and Huaweis, and say, we want to solve these problems, and can we do it together, and can we do it in such a way that it helps to facilitate this integration that we have, so that you can actually start to talk about things like, if that data center fails because of an earthquake, how are these other data centers going to pick it up? And then you have a software base to actually start to articulate those conversations. And this is kind of exciting. It's going to be slow going, is my prediction, because you're actually dealing with some really complex topics, but it should help with this.
Right. And I mean, number one is always requirements analysis. And I'm not sure if the service providers all agree. I mean, a lot of organizations understand their own business and technical requirements for operating their services, but how much the industry can align on this, it's an interesting challenge.
Good.
Okay, just two more things on the ETSI plug test that we participated in. So it's not an ENTC or new IP agency initiative, it's an ETSI initiative. ETSI runs some test themselves, and this plug test allowed both commercial and open source implementations to participate. So here we have an example of a case where vendors delegated staff to officially support open source initiatives to participate. It was a fairly large crowd there, and it was actually a face-to-face in-person test event. The test that we conducted with a new IP agency, they are mostly remote and distributed. We counted a total of 85 vendor engineers participating in one of the campaigns, but we only saw 13 of them ever on site. So this is a face-to-face test event, and they tested MANO as well, so was focusing mostly on the VNF lifecycle management, network service lifecycle management. Next slide. So plug test participants are quite a few grouped into the VNFs on the left-hand side, the MANOs on the center, and the infrastructure on the right-hand side. And I tried to color those in yellow that are open source. Apologies if the yellow doesn't come out the same. I failed fighting with Google Docs here in the colors, but basically you see everything that's open on the left-hand side, open Baton, open O, open source MANO, and OPNFV, open VIM, OpenStack platform. So basically, these are open source based or direct open source implementations that participated.
And from the results, they had a very positive outcome. So around like 97-98% of all combinations were okay. And I think, again, this is due to the fact that vendors who started testing and they figured it would fail, they just didn't report it. And so that's what you have to deal with. The ETSI plug tests have a different focus than the new IP agency. New IP agency says we want to report anything and we will actually log everything on, you know, my team logs all the results and there's no way to escape this. In the ETSI plug test, it's an engineering focused event. They don't publish detailed results. This is the only results that are available on the actual implementation level. And they say this is, if the vendors don't want to report it, then it's their own deal.
I think on the open source side, I know for OpenNV, the approach was that if we find a fault, we run everything, and if we find a fault, we raise a ticket. Right?
So mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, sure.
We're there to learn. Good.
And again, you know, the main benefit is learning, right? It's not about like finger pointing or blaming or something. And that's, of course, on the commercial marketing side, that's always a conflict of goals. You know, if you learn, then you want to be as much failing as possible to learn from it. If you want to be great on marketing, you have to be able to publish a press release like we completed thousands of combinations successfully. And these are different goals.
Good. So we have 20 minutes left, 19 minutes left. I'm going to quickly talk a little bit about the vendor challenges that we have. And we can more or less stop and take questions as well. We don't have a lot of time remaining. We've done pretty well thus far. But I did want to cover two main points. One is when it comes to building an interoperable application. Back when I was building applications in before this NFV time, it was great. You bought a box, you put an operating system on it, you built your software, you put that on top of it, you then tested it, and you knew it worked. And you could go out to a customer, you could put it into the wall and plug it on and switch it on, and it would work just the way it did when you built it. And life was relatively okay.
I
know, the good old days. Yeah. Now we're in a virtual environment. Now I don't even know what the box I'm running on looks like anymore, let alone have control of which operating system that I'm running on. So the world changes a little bit. But even though I'm in a world where I don't necessarily have the same foundation, I still have certain expectations when it comes to selling my software. I need to be able to provide predictable performance, predictable scalability, and predictable operability, which we talked a little bit about thus far. I need to be able to, an operator, someone buying my software needs to be able to use it. And that's fine if the software is relatively simple, but more complex the software gets, the more it has dependencies on the traffic coming in or going out of it, and the more it's government regulated, the more challenging that becomes. It also needs to be lifecycle managed. So I don't necessarily know what operating system I'm running on or what is lifecycle managing my software. However, it needs to still work effectively as a lifecycle managed object. It needs to be able to be upgraded. It needs to operate in a resilient manner. It needs to have methods of reporting and methods of getting input that are well understood regardless of where it's running. And this is a huge challenge. And we talk about how it was with Juno and we were running on VMware, or it was Red Hat this or Canonical that, and they were all very different a few years ago. And it was, you literally had to do everything over and over and over again, depending on what your target was. And that's what we need to move away from, because if I write 1,000 lines of code, I want to be able to sell 1,000 lines of code. I don't want to be able to sell 1,000 lines of code and 3 million lines of tests because I have 20 platforms I have to hit. Then it's not worth making the software. The other is interoperability, of course. Standard interfaces, so it doesn't matter what I'm running on, it doesn't matter where I'm running it, I still need to provide the same standard interfaces, otherwise the phone can't connect to the system. You know, there's some basic things that we still have to maintain and bring forwards, and predictable characteristics. If there's too much lag, it's not going to work. If there's too much delay, it's not going to work. If there's enough throughput, it's not going to work for the services that consumers want to buy. So from a vendor perspective, life sucks right now, I think is the best way I can describe it. But it's getting better, and it's getting better because of a lot of the things we've talked about today. I think if I'm an operator, I'm thinking of buying. I want to buy. What do I expect when I'm buying? Well, I expect to be able to click to buy. I would love this to be in an app store type of thing. I want to press that button and I want it to be up and running and I want a new horizontal service deployed. That's cool. In fact, that's an awesome target, and that's the target we have in mind when we build things these days. That's where we're trying to go. But it's kind of challenging. We need application portability. It needs to be able to run on this cloud or that cloud, and that cloud can be data center cloud or central office cloud, and it can be running different versions of an operating system. We still need to be able to manage this. The management and orchestration layer needs to be able to tell my application where to run, and I should just follow the marching orders and go and run where I'm meant to run. Functions, of course, have to be interoperable, and the tricky part is it has to be multi-vendor. In other words, everyone else has to be able to do the same thing that we're doing. And that's where it gets really tricky, because unless it's available in an open and common way, which is what open source is all about, it's very hard for us to all approach a problem with the same mindset. And end-to-end automation, of course, comes into it. So we have this little arrow I have on the side, and it really talks about the foundation pieces, doing the common things in open source, using the interop working group in OpenStack, using the CVP in OpenNFV, and pushing things there. As a vendor, I want to push as much there as I can, because if I can push stuff there, then I can start to answer some of the questions of where is my application going to land? What is it going to be running on? What are the interfaces it has to use? The more certain I can be about that, the faster I can write software. And the more certain I can be about deploying that software. So really, we talked earlier about pushing a lot of the testing back down the track. It's really important as an operator, if you're thinking about buying a particular system, if you know how that system should look, find the earliest possible point in that chain to get that test running, so that operators, or so that vendors trying to sell you that can hit that context as early as possible. Then, of course, things like ETSI NFV TST, it's a standard for testing. This is how we're going to test. This is how we're going to be measured. And we can all sort of align and agree on that. It's relatively straightforward, and it provides us with a really nice foundation for coming out to a customer and saying, we followed this. And the customer's like, oh, good, now I know what you've done. And I'm relatively comfortable with that. Then some of the vendor activities, NVIoT is up there, and that's been around for a long time now. That's where all the vendors got together and we said, okay, I've got an EPG and I've got an MME and I've got all these sorts of things, and we plug them together and we make sure they work as vendors. And that helps us solve that interoperability challenge. What it hasn't traditionally done is made them all virtual activities and run them in different data centers and things like that. So there is a new initiative called the NFV ITI, which is looking at addressing how we can get those applications running on each other's softwares and hardwares, which is in a similar area to the certification work or compliance work that the new IP agency does. So a lot of this sort of feeds up to the point where you get to that commercial readiness piece, right? You do need to do the interoperability testing before you go to someone's lab to certify that it works. You need to know that it works. You need to know that it works based on what you've pushed into open source, so that you know that the applications and interfaces you're going to use are going to actually feed into that. So it's kind of a chain that we see, which comes to the point of where and how do I achieve click to buy? How do I make it easy for operators to iterate? Because if operators can iterate quickly, if operators can click a button, have a virtual network spun up, and be able to test that safely in a secure, isolated environment, me as a software vendor, I can start to have a conversation with them about how much lifecycle management I have to invest in, how much backward compatibility has to be through every component in the stack. Where can I start to do stuff quicker so that they can start to do stuff quicker? It's a cycle that we have to get into. And it's not the vendors and it's not the operators alone that have to do this. We have to get together, we have to collaborate, and we have to find the ways to make this faster, better. And all of these interoperability challenges that we're working with all feed into that.
And by the way, the application layer is an interesting point that shouldn't be underestimated. In the beginning, everybody thought, well, the application layer doesn't change. You know, if a vendor had a virtual an EPC implementation before, they just take it and they port it, and then it's cloud something. But it's actually only cloud ready, maybe. It's not cloud native, and I understood the difference can be pretty major in terms of like a cloud ready implementation can be pretty monolithic. It doesn't really take any of the major benefits of the virtualization. It just, you know, says like, okay, now we can run it somehow in the cloud, and on the way to getting cloud native, the application needs to change quite dramatically in some cases. So all the application layer needs to be retested.
Yeah, anyone, raise your hands if you've tried to run a diameter stack across 1,000 containers. Yeah, you'd be insane to do so. No, you wouldn't. But these are the types of challenges that we have to address. When we were standardizing around diameter, we weren't thinking of spinning up 500 containers here and 5,000 containers over there and that they should all interoperate. That wasn't part of how we envisioned the network working. So there's changes across the stack. As you say, the application level adjusts. But from a vendor perspective, I mean, I come back to the ONS harmonize, harness, consume. This is really the message. It's spot on for where we are as an industry at this point in time. I mean, we need to find ways of harmonizing around the interfaces, the environments, the processes, the workflows. We need to figure out how to make the most of the software that's available to us, and then we need to get that into the network as quickly as possible. And this cycle of harness, harmonize, consume is what we need to speed up. And that's really what all of this is about. That's why we want CD, why we want CI, why we want interop, why we want automation. That's what's going to help. So that's the vendor's view, I guess, on where we want to go. The vendor's view on how much effort it's going to cost to get there is maybe not as shiny, but we're still okay. So that's really all I wanted to talk about from my perspective. We have 10 minutes for questions, and we have a concluding slide. So,
any questions?
Yeah, any questions? Otherwise, I'll ask my fellow panelists questions, which you don't want to see happen. Oh, sorry. No, just we'll repeat it.
Is there work somewhere, like where's the best place for work on templates, or some sort of universal template for onboarding virtual functions and wrapping them with additional metadata to support all the processes?
So the question was where do we go to work on that universal template that helps us onboard applications, wrap them in processes and policies, and allow us to click to buy? There is some work being done in Tosca by ETSI. There is work being done in the newly forming ONAP project, and then there is a lot of work being done. I mean, you know, products like Juju and other products have done a lot of work around this. But that universal template that agreed on, this is how we're going to do it, that's a work in progress at this point. We don't have something we can point at and say, there we go. And the reason is it's a tough question to answer. And there are a lot of things that, you know, if Ericsson sat down to try and do it, and we even talked to Nokia, and we agreed on how we do it, and we can bring Huawei in and Cisco in, and we can sort of agree on how to do it, we're still only addressing 40% of what it needs to do. It's a big industry question. But I hope to see ETSI, I hope to see the ONAP project, I hope to see the work being done in Tosca sort of over the next 12 months or so really start to answer some of these questions and give us, you know, at least 80% of what we need to get there. That would be ideal. And the TM forum, of course, yes. All right, quickly.
Definitely. And I think we're seeing something maybe a little further down the stream in the SDN, on the SDN transport side of things. So in SDN implementations have adopted NetConf and Yang models to describe the services. And the challenge there is always to find a Yang model which is multi-vendor ready. Everybody has their own Yang model. Like everybody had their own SNMP MIP in the old days. And that, of course, not going to help much, because even if you agree on the protocol, like NetConf to exchange it, that's only half of the game, right? So hats off to any initiative here that's trying to harmonize the models, because they're going to find a way for vendors to still differentiate from each other, because vendors can't differentiate anymore, they can't sell their services anymore, their solutions, and at the same time standardize the model sufficiently enough to make life easier for service providers.
Game for me.
So I was curious, you had that sort of graph, the up and to the right graph, and if there's a place that OPNFV fits in there somewhere, you know, you went right from open source right into, it seemed like, vendor.
Yeah, I've got the logo down here next to OpenStack. It's actually interesting because OPNFV is a little further down the line than OpenStack, but when it comes to how as a vendor, if you remember, how I as a vendor approach doing this, OPNFV is still before I try and productify something. So for me, it's still part of that pre-design cycle. It's kind of open source integration and open source consolidation. So I do have it down here in the open source interoperability piece. It can be debated. It was a quickly put together slide. No, I didn't say that.
We weren't sure about the sequence, so it's not a strict order. So if you take screenshot of this, don't say like this comes before the other, because the NFVI ETSI people, they were somewhere here. Yeah, so they're here. But I, as far as I understood the initiative, it's often working with service providers and avoiding like the finger pointing to. It's an MOU that says like if we find like the vendors find ourselves in the same service provider and our versions or our software doesn't work with each other, then we do not finger point. We actually help each other, and that's sounds trivial, but it's a major achievement. And so the pipeline might not be in the right order, but in any way, I think it underlines the whole paradigm thing, and we have to sort out how this would work. More questions?
Do you see containers creating even more problems as they start to get more popular? Docker, Kubernetes?
From OpenStack perspective, we are trying to support containers as much as possible. We are seeing containers be a hot topic from multiple perspectives, not just there's an initiative that easily get the fingers pointed at from the perspective of, oh, we just put our things into containers and then it will solve our problems, because then that will most probably will make it cloud ready / native / cloud - star. It's not actually true. Containers are not equal to solve our problems out of the box that we didn't spend time and energy and effort on solving it. So from this perspective, I think containers are even a bigger challenge. So it's not how the technologies fit together, but how the mindset will be ready to deal with containers. On the other hand, we also see containers, for example, in HPC and scientific workloads. Like, for example, I don't want my researcher to be an engineer and do all the infrastructure layer coding, because it's not the main purpose. So there's another area where containers can come into the picture, but we are just dealing with the same / similar issues than how we are dealing with the VMs and how we are onboarding it.
Exactly. And from a vendor's perspective, actually it can help and it can hinder depending on what the challenge you're facing is. It helps in that I just have to target a kernel version that I want to run on, and I don't have to necessarily worry about host and guest interoperability and KVM versions and stuff like that anymore. It can hinder not so much in the container itself, but the container control plane and how that interacts with my, for instance, OpenStack control plane, and how I couple these things together. The networking is we have some work to do on networking when it comes to how we're adopting and working with containers. There is some great work on the KNS stuff about how to bring some of the Kubernetes stuff into OpenStack. I see a lot of really good progress, and if we continue to make that progress, I don't think they're going to be a huge problem for us. Something like OCI, Open Container Initiative, gives us a standard packaging format. When containers first came out, we were like, yay, we have a new version of a tarball, because that's really what they provided you, a way to package up stuff And you didn't have to untar it to run it. You just downloaded it and run it, and it was perfect. It's moved on from there. When we talk about containers, we now talk a little more about control planes and networking and how they interact and how they scale. And it's that control plane part where I think we need to continue to invest. But in general, I'm actually very supportive of containers and how they can help us with interoperability. If all I have to worry about is my OCI format, and all I have to worry about is that I have a compatible kernel, and as long as I can trust that the control plane is relatively cohesive to what I expect, I think from a deployment perspective, it can help simplify. And we may be out of time, so I'll let these guys wrap up. That's me done. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. So thank you all for coming. This is what we had for interoperability for today. But as you could hear, it's we don't have the conclusion. We are not ready with everything. So I would like to encourage all of you to look up the related open and open source activities and join there and provide feedback, participate, write test cases or code, and just share your experience with us, because this is what will bring us and the industry forward.
Yeah. No closing words. Thanks very much for attending, and I hope it was useful.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
And you can find us around the whole week.